It was scripts and story that I couldn't get out of my head. I found myself thinking about it all the time. And, you know, that led to the moment where I was like, I'd love to pitch on this and join the party, I suppose. I definitely think that, you know, the treatment of this story is hopefully complex and empathetic and respectful to everyone involved. And I think, you know, it's a story about different truths that are, you know, presented to you and inviting you to have an opinion on those truths, and also the truths that you tell yourself, perhaps to get by. And I think in the making of the show, we are honest with you, the audience, about the fact that we also are just storytellers, and this is just a version of the truth. This is just a version of the story. A lot of the visual decisions that were made were to try to get you into the headspace of the characters of Susan and Christopher. And I think, you know, for example, like the way we use red and green, that's kind of like the bodies were found buried in a backyard, and in our show, they're buried under some red and green flowers. And so the colours red and green came to be used in a way that was emblematic of the murder or symbolic of guilt, if you like, and kind of haunt the more romantic aesthetics that are also at play in the show. So, you know, if you're remembering some beautiful romantic moment of when you were first getting together, Susan being someone who was particularly enamoured with classic Hollywood films and old westerns, it might play in a certain way, and then at another time it might play in a sort of more foreboding, unnerving way, and almost kind of theatrical way, I guess, which hopefully invites the audience to sort of see the same story, the same truths in different ways depending on how it's presented to you.
You're blessed with two of the finest performers in the world, with David and Olivia. Can you talk a little bit about what you think makes them both so very special and what they specifically bring to these performances?
Well, I think both of them are, first of all, just really lovely to work with and lovely human beings. Very generous on set, always prepared. But also I think they're both very versatile and especially good at kind of navigating the line between the light and the dark. I think they're as good at, you know, selling a comedic beat as they are being vulnerable and selling a dramatic moment. And I think they just both bring a real lightness of touch to these characters, a real humanity. And just together as well, I think they really sell this sort of romantic aspect of landscapers. Because I guess it is a true crime drama, but it almost more than that, I think of it as a kind of romantic psychodrama, and it's about the sort of psychology of the fictionalized version of these characters.
My character is called Douglas, and the way he fits in the story, he's the solicitor chosen by Susan. She almost chose him straight away. It's almost too quick.
Hey man, you're right.
You're good. Almost too quick, and he just tries to help Susan in any way that he can, and he really just wants to do the best job that he can possibly. So he just fits in kind of into the narrative really beautifully. I think Olivia's, I'll say this time and time again, not for both Olivia and David, but Olivia is one of the best actors that's come out of this country, I think, ever. And she is such a human in this that I think it's just perfect, the way she just presents herself as somebody who's fallible but also powerful.
The production has quite fantastical elements, but it's based very much on real people, real crimes, real events. Did you have any particular sensitivity on set because of that?
Yeah, I think ultimately we were telling our version of the story and not a true crime retelling. So it meant that we knew what happened, we knew the events, but also we knew that we were in a different world to a certain extent. And I think you'll see that when you see the series itself.
So I play Detective Constable Emma Lansing. And she has her spidey senses out, basically, for Christopher and Susan. She thinks the Witcherleys were murdered. She thinks they did it, and she's going to pin it on them. And she just goes hell for leather with that, basically. She's sniffing them down. Everything about it is singular, from the characters of Christopher and Susan to the story itself, to the way Ed approaches the story, which is a surprising angle, and then with Will, who's just so talented with such creative vision. Everything about it was distinctive, and that's what I was excited about. I didn't really think about the comedy, to be honest. I guess the key was just to keep it straight, keep the guard up, and keep. And I guess there's something about that Nottingham sensibility that's like, no bull, like just going straight for it. I didn't need to. Didn't feel the need to get in any gags there because it's in the writing. So it was just playing the scene. So I actually didn't think too hard about the comedy. It's kind of already there. I don't think there was any judgment made on whether they needed to tone it down or something. You know, it was just kind of accepted that's what happened. I don't feel that anyone was nervous about confronting that head on, you know, like, that's what happened. I think life is kind of colourful and full of kind of strange, unexpected happenings. Well, I think, actually, I think it's important to not have everything black and white, particularly with drama, particularly in a time where everyone's just shouting at each other on Twitter with kind of black and white views. To have something that's a surprising angle and to humanise the people is important right now. And I think that they're not allowed to get away with it in this telling either, because you have the police, and at the forefront of Emma's mind is very much two people have been murdered and we need justice. And that's it. So you have a kind of counterpoint in it as well, but it's sort of a rich, there's a depth to the piece, I think, that's not so straightforward. Look, I think Olivia is always such a truthful actress that you always believe. She just gets to the nub of it. And I guess what I was amazed by working with her was just her phenomenal instinct. She is not heady in any way. She can be chatting or having a laugh, the camera goes on and she can access anywhere on that emotional landscape very quickly. She's quite extraordinary, yeah. I think storytelling will always matter, and I think it was really important to people with lockdown. I think storytelling, you know, in all the mediums is about making sense of our life, our lives, you know. That's why we use narrative. We'll always have it in all the different ways, I think.
It's a crime series in that it's definitely about the true story of this crime, but I think we were very keen not to go down a sort of standard procedural route. Firstly, there's no doubt about, really, about what they did and that they're guilty. And so we know who done it. In that sense, but I think the more interesting side of it was why they did it and why they got to the position before that almost, and what their relationship was about. And they are obviously people who have told each other stories to cope with whatever they've had to cope with in their lives throughout their whole lives, and I think that's just a really fascinating thing, and something we all do, and something it's worth considering. I think it's just an interesting question. Yeah. An incredible story in real life terms. Lots of things that didn't make sense, and lots of really wild details. They had a pen pal relationship with Gerard Depardieu. They were massive fans of this is Susan and Chris, the murderers. They had a massive collection of memorabilia that ended up being worth next to nothing at all. They were on the run in France. They sort of sent polite emails to the police. All of it was just wild and fascinating, but didn't really make sense. And so, that I guess we're all sort of natural storytellers. I think everyone reading that case was trying to work out what that was about and how those people got there. And so that was the kind of motivation for it, I suppose. Trying to work out how those people, both the victims and the perpetrators, got to that point. And I mean, I don't want to in any way diminish the awfulness of the crimes that they committed, but I think what tends to happen when someone's convicted of a crime is that sort of one's view of them crystallizes around that. So instantly Chris and Susan became cold-hearted killers in the view of the press, and probably in the view of most people. But I think life's much more complicated than that, and there were details of their lives that brought them to where they were that makes us wonder. And I don't think I have an answer to that, really. The series is about asking questions rather than answering them, and that question in particular about where our sympathies should lie when lives are complicated, when there are all sorts of things that go on in people's lives, and in Susan's life in particular, when she was a young girl, that were nothing to do with her and not her fault in the slightest, and she couldn't escape, that I think to a certain extent made her the person she is today. Yeah. So it was all about that. Well, I guess, I mean, I can talk to what makes Olivia special, because I kind of, you know, I live with that day in day. She's like a like emotionally like a coiled spring. She'll cry at anything. She's so open emotionally and sort of available emotionally to sort of hope and sadness and joy and all the rest of it that she, you know, she's got that and she's able to access that whilst performing as well, which is, I think, a real gift. And she does it seemingly effortlessly. David is very similar, I think. David, Olivia and I have been massive fans of David for a long time. He probably is one of the reasons we ended up going to drama school back in the day. We watched him in Naked and Mike Leigh's Naked, which was just one of the, you know, the all-timers, and just absolutely fell in love with that, and fell in love, I suppose, with the idea of what performance on screen and on stage can bring. And so that was David, and so incredible to, like, all this time later to find for us all to be working together.
Well, Susan and Christopher Edwards, and they are real people who, in 1998, murdered Susan's parents. It's not a whodunit. We were told that from the very beginning, and what we've decided to do, what Ed and Will decided to do, is look at this as a love story, which is a rather controversial way of approaching a true life, true crime story. And therefore, that's how I looked at it. I think how Olivia looked at it, going, let's look at this, not to forget what really happened, but to look at that first, and then paste on top of that the horror of what they actually did, but see them therefore as real people before we see them as victims of themselves and perpetrators of a crime, but to get to the real emotional people first and then look at the rest. Well, I admired how brave the script was and how Will has been in attempting to tell a potentially very dark story, an incredibly dark story, but to take it and turn it into something very unique, very magical, very surreal, very unexpected, never quite sure what's going to happen next. Even I saw it the other night, and I sometimes never guess what the next shot is going to be, and it's constantly surprising. And I think that comes from the way we experienced it as filmmakers. It was constantly surprising to us how we came into each scene, and I think that's up there on the screen. It's constantly changing. We're in several different worlds, several different. We shot on lots of different cameras, lots of different film stocks, and we go into fantasy worlds, flashbacks. We go into a Hollywood Western world. So that obviously made it constantly stimulating for us as actors to be living in these worlds, and constantly stimulating for us to be trying to keep the reality of the performances in this kind of Buñuel-esque kind of madness, you know.
You have worked recently with one of the great directors in James Cameron with the Avatar project. Can you talk a little bit about what your experience was like working with him and stepping? I mean, again, that's a completely different fantasy experience, particularly, I would assume, a lot of green screen and a lot of water tanks.
No green screen at all, actually, for me, because I'm a Navi, so it was all motion capture for me, so which doesn't involve green screen at all, and that was a totally new experience for me. I'd never shot in that way before. I felt very naive and very inexperienced. Jim Cameron was very, very, very wonderful director to work for. I was a little worried at first because I'd heard stories that he was difficult, and he wasn't difficult at all. I admired him very much, and was a very wonderful gentleman, and very humorous and very, very generous. And I didn't quite get anything I'd been told otherwise. And I haven't seen any of that. I did it quite a long time ago now, but I've got no idea what that's going to be like. And I wasn't in water. No. As far as I understand, I know Jim has pushed forward boundaries of technology even further. Well, it's one of the fascinating things about Jim is he's a film director, obviously, but he's also an artist. He's sat at the side of the stage sketching the characters, sketching the production design, and he's also an engineer, which I think g- gives him an edge in terms of pushing forward new technologies. I know there were new cameras being used, totally new experience in motion capture being used. I've seen just a small fraction of what's been going on, but if there's anyone who can really push cinema into a new zone, I think it's him.
We're also very excited about The Sandman, as are a lot of fans. Can you tell us a little bit about where you fit into that new world? Because I think there's been a huge fan appetite to see that brought to life on screen for many years now.
Yes. Well, I played Dr. D in it. I'm not sure how much I can say beyond that. I mean, we had a wonderful time. It was made at the start of this year at Shepperton Studios, and I'm hesitating because I'm not sure how much I'm allowed to say for now, but it was a wonderful experience, and it's going to be something quite bizarre, I would imagine. I know that the parts I was involved in, I mean, I'm only in 3 or 4 episodes, I think, were absolutely extraordinary. I haven't seen any of it. I don't know. I've not seen one frame of it yet. But I'm looking forward to that as much as anyone else.
During lockdown, people turned to a lot of things to escape, and one of the most popular things, apparently, was Harry Potter fan fiction. I'm curious if you've ever dipped your toes in that water, because there is, in particular, one Harry Potter fan fiction based particularly around your character in Sirius Black. There's now been read over 4 million times, and people are comparing it to the books in terms of quality, and I'm curious how you feel about that, to have had people take the character and run with it to that extent.
I've no idea about that. I don't know anything about that. I honestly don't. I don't know what you're talking about. So I don't know. I don't read Harry Potter fan fiction. I look at Harry Potter like a film I did many years ago, just like any other films I did years ago. It wasn't something. I know people are very obsessive about it and huge fans about it. But for me as an actor, I think I was in the third film significantly. After that, I was only in it now and again. So it's not something that I live with every day, and I certainly don't read Harry Potter fan fiction. You know.
If you ever have a spare 100 hours, there's a 500,000 word book written about your character in Sirius Black online. 4 million people have read it, apparently.
I don't even know about that, yeah. I mean, I really don't, yeah. Is it good?
Supposedly, they're hoping it'll be made into a film. But anyway, yeah.
Oh, maybe I could be in it then.